The Age of Annie. It was the dawn of a new age in America. Movies were taking off. Great buildings were being built. And remarkable inventions were changing our lives forever. Want to discover more about this amazing time? Watch a clip from the movie and then answer a question about it to go back in time to the Age of Annie. Here's the first clip. Pay close attention to the landmarks. In which city does Annie take place? That's right. Annie takes place in New York City. In the 1930s, New York City was a place of extraordinary extremes. A city where the very poor lived just a few blocks from the very rich. Where the smallest shanties were shadowed by the world's tallest skyscrapers. New York's most exciting new landmark during the Age of Annie was the Empire State Building. When this amazing skyscraper was completed in 1931, it was the tallest building in the world. The Empire State had taken only 2 years to build, and that's because more than 3,000 men worked on it. What did they all do? Well, there were 255 carpenters, 290 bricklayers, 285 steel men, 249 elevator installers, 105 electricians, and 192 plumbers, to mention just a few. When it was finished, the Empire State was 1,453 feet to the top of the lightning rod. That's right, lightning rod. The building serves as a lightning rod for the surrounding city, and it's struck by lightning about 100 times each year. This next clip shows the huge gap between rich and poor during the Age of Annie. In which decade does Annie... That's right! Annie takes place in the 1930s. To understand the 1930s, you need to know just a bit about the decade right before it, the 1920s. The Roaring Twenties, as some people called them, had been a decade of wealth, glitz, and a whole lot of fun. But in 1929, the stock market crashed and the party was over. By 1930, people everywhere were out of work and hungry. To make matters worse, a severe drought made it impossible for farmers to grow crops. And our great farmland turned into a giant dust bowl. Some people were so poor they couldn't feed their own families, so many parents left their children in orphanages so they could look for work in other cities. That's why the orphanages in Annie are so full of children. Don't feel too sad, though, because later you'll see how America lifted itself out of the Great Depression. Now, here's a clip of Punjab doing some magic. As you can see, Punjab can make things... That's right! Making something appear to magically lift off the ground is called levitation. In fact, the dictionary defines levitation as the rising or lifting of a person or thing by means held to be supernatural. In the Age of Annie, magic truly was one of the most popular forms of entertainment. The most famous acts included... the dancing handkerchief and the floating light bulb. Audiences across the nation were left breathless by the sight of these astounding feats. Now, let's look at some beautiful cars. This next question's a doozy. Well, that was a clue, by the way. Good going. Daddy's cars were a DuPont and a Duesenberg. Let's look at Daddy's DuPont town car first. If you've ever been to a hardware store, you might think that DuPont makes paint. And you'd be right. But between 1919 and 1932, DuPont manufactured about 500 of the most beautiful and luxurious cars ever built, with seats covered in velvet and window shades made of silk. Now, do you remember me saying that this question is a doozy? Well, that expression actually comes from the name Duesenberg. In the 1920s and 30s, the Duesenberg brothers, Frederick and August, were the makers of what many called the world's finest motor car. Truly a cut above. Duesenbergs were owned by kings.
Take me to the palace.
Movie stars.
I'm off to see Mr. DeMille.
Politicians.
Vote for me.
And even gangsters. With a top speed of 115 miles per hour, they made great getaway cars. Ready for the next clip? Good. Let's look at some Age of Annie fashions.
My new folks, they're poor. All these clothes are going to make them feel bad. Could you maybe take them back to the orphanage and give them to my friends?
Certainly.
This'll look so cute on Molly. And this'll look good on Duffy.
And here's a funny question. That's right, buttons were more expensive. So for many people, it was goodbye buttons and hello zippers. During the Great Depression, most women couldn't afford new clothes. They made their own clothes at home or simply updated the ones they already had. Waistlines got a little higher and necklines got just a little lower. And because it was too expensive to copy the Paris fashions that everyone loved,
au revoir,
we looked instead to our own American movie star styles for inspiration. And what about shoes? Well, most people could only afford one pair. And so, shoe clips decorated with ribbons, or even those pricey buttons, were clipped onto shoes to make them look different each time they were worn. Isn't that clever? You're doing great. Let's visit the White House now.
It's nice to meet you, Mr. President.
My pleasure, Annie. And thank you for bringing the old goat. We'll make a new dealer of him yet.
Inconceivable.
Don't mind him, Oliver.
Come along, Annie.
Which president does Annie go to see? That's right. It was Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the only president to be elected four times. Roosevelt was born in 1882, and as the lucky son of wealthy parents, young Franklin floated through a comfortable childhood. But by the time he was elected to the White House, the country was in the midst of the Great Depression. And so, Roosevelt knew his most important task as president was to get the American people back on their feet. He came up with a revolutionary plan called the New Deal. The New Deal created millions of jobs for Americans, building highways, reforesting land, creating airports, even putting on plays. It was a great idea. The New Deal built and beautified our country while helping families feel more hopeful about their future. Roosevelt died in 1945, but many of his great ideas are still helping people today. Now, let's look at some Age of Annie technology. What is Daddy Warbucks' flying machine? That's right, it's called the autocopter. In the 1930s, many people were very excited about these new flying machines, which today, of course, we call helicopters. The idea of helicopters goes all the way back to the 15th century, when a great inventor named Leonardo da Vinci designed this unusual machine. He wasn't able to build it, but he knew that one day a helicopter would fly. For years and years, inventors everywhere struggled in vain to make Da Vinci's dream a reality. And by the 1930s, the first autocopters were taking off in Europe. They were brought to the United States by a businessman named Harold Pitcairn. Pitcairn did so much to promote these new machines that he was given a trophy on the front lawn of the White House. How did he get there? By autocopter, of course. For our last clip, let's look at entertainment in the age of Annie.
6, 7, 8, you're on.
I-O-D-E-N-T-I-O-D-E-N-T.
Hey, hobo man, hey, Dapper Dan. You both got your style, but brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile.
Here's your final question about the age. That's right, radio came first. In 1895, an Italian inventor, Guglielmo Marconi,
come on,
successfully sent the very first radio signal a few miles through the air. But that wasn't enough for Marconi. Only 6 years later, he sent a message all the way across the Atlantic Ocean. That's more than 3,000 miles. By the age of Annie, just about every American household had a radio. And just like we watch TV today, families gathered around their radios every night to listen to their favorite programs. Miss Hannigan's favorite show was The Romance of Helen Trent, the romantic saga of a glamorous dress designer.
Kiss me.
Helen Trent ran for 27 years, from 1933 to 1960, with 7,200 episodes. Quite a run. Guess what? You've just mastered the age of Annie. Congratulations! The age of Annie. It was the dawn of a new age in America. Movies were taking off. Great buildings were being built. And remarkable inventions were changing our lives forever. Want to discover more about this amazing time? Watch a clip from the movie and then answer a question about it to go back in time to the age of Annie. Here's the first clip. Pay close attention to the landmarks. This next clip shows the huge gap between rich and poor during the age of Annie. Now, here's a clip of Punjab doing some magic. Now, let's look at some beautiful cars. Ready for the next clip? Good! Let's look at some Age of Annie fashions.
My new folks, they're poor. All these clothes are gonna make them feel bad. Could you maybe take them back to the orphanage and give them to my friends?
Certainly.
This'll look so cute on Molly. And this'll look good on Duffy.
You're doing great. Let's visit the White House now.
It's nice to meet you, Mr. President.
My pleasure, Annie. And thank you for bringing the old goat. We'll make a new dealer of him yet.
Inconceivable.
Don't mind him, Oliver.
Come along, Annie.
Now, let's look at some Age of Annie technology. For our last clip, let's look at entertainment in the age of Annie.
6, 7, 8, you're on.
I-O-D-E-N-T-I-O, dent.
Hey, hobo man, hey, dapper Dan. You both got your style, but brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile.
In which city does Annie take place? Chicago, New York, or Los Angeles? In which decade does Annie take place? The 1930s, the 1940s, or the 1950s? As you can see, Punjab can make things magically lift off the ground. Is his magical skill called levitation, meditation, or procrastination? This next question's a doozy. Well, that was a clue, by the way. Which two cars does Daddy Warbucks own? A Rolls-Royce and a Ford, a Mustang and a Jeep, or a DuPont and a Duesenberg? And here's a funny question. In the 1930s, which were more expensive, buttons or zippers? Which president does Annie go to see? Lincoln, Washington, or Roosevelt? What is Daddy Warbucks' flying machine called? A helicopter, an autocopter, or a whirlybird? Here's your final question about the age of Annie. Which was invented first, radio or television? Not quite. Take another guess. Not Los Angeles. Think of a city on the East Coast. Not the 40s. Try again. No, not the 50s. Take another guess. No, meditation is when you're very quiet and concentrate your mind on something. Take another guess. No, procrastination means to put off doing something, like homework. Kids sometimes procrastinate with their homework. Try again. Not quite. Remember my clue. It's a doozy. I think a Mustang's a little modern for the age of Annie. Try again. Oops. Well, there's only one other choice, isn't there? No, not Lincoln. He was the president during the Civil War, from 1861 to 1865. Not Washington. He was the first president of the United States. Not a helicopter. Try again. Not quite. Take another guess. Not quite. Television was invented in 1925, exactly 30 years after radio. That's right. Annie takes place in New York City. In the 1930s, New York City was a place of extraordinary extremes. A city where the very poor lived just a few blocks from the very rich. Where the smallest shanties were shadowed by the world's tallest skyscrapers. New York's most exciting new landmark during the Age of Annie was the Empire State Building. When this amazing skyscraper was completed in 1931, it was the tallest building in the world. The Empire State had taken only 2 years to build, and that's because more than 3,000 men worked on it. What did they all do? Well, there were 255 carpenters, 290 bricklayers, 285 steel men, 249 elevator installers, 105 electricians, and 192 plumbers, to mention just a few. When it was finished, the Empire State was 1,453 feet to the top of the lightning rod. That's right, lightning rod. The building serves as a lightning rod for the surrounding city, and it's struck by lightning about 100 times each year. That's right, Annie takes place in the 1930s. To understand the 1930s, you need to know just a bit about the decade right before it, the 1920s. The Roaring Twenties, as some people called them, had been a decade of wealth, glitz, and a whole lot of fun. But in 1929, the stock market crashed and the party was over. By 1930, people everywhere were out of work and hungry. To make matters worse, a severe drought made it impossible for farmers to grow crops. And our great farmland turned into a giant dust bowl. Some people were so poor they couldn't feed their own families, so many parents left their children in orphanages so they could look for work in other cities. That's why the orphanages in Annie are so full of children. Don't feel too sad, though, because later you'll see how America lifted itself out of the Great Depression. That's right. Making something appear to magically lift off the ground is called levitation. In fact, the dictionary defines levitation as the rising or lifting of a person or thing by means held to be supernatural. In the Age of Annie, magic truly was one of the most popular forms of entertainment. The most famous acts included the dancing handkerchief and the floating light bulb. Audiences across the nation were left breathless by the sight of these astounding feats. Good going! Daddy's cars were a DuPont and a Duesenberg. Let's look at Daddy's DuPont town car first. If you've ever been to a hardware store, you might think that DuPont makes paint. And you'd be right. But between 1919 and 1932, DuPont manufactured about 500 of the most beautiful and luxurious cars ever built, with seats covered in velvet and window shades made of silk. Now, do you remember me saying that this question is a doozy? Well, that expression actually comes from the name Duesenberg. In the 1920s and 30s, the Duesenberg brothers, Frederick and August, were the makers of what many called the world's finest motor car. Truly a cut above. Duesenbergs were owned by kings.
Take me to the palace.
Movie stars.
I'm off to see Mr. DeMille.
Politicians.
Vote for me.
And even gangsters. With a top speed of 115 miles per hour, they made great getaway cars. That's right, buttons were more expensive. So for many people, it was goodbye buttons and hello zippers. During the Great Depression, most women couldn't afford new clothes. They made their own clothes at home, or simply updated the ones they already had. Waistlines got a little higher, and necklines got just a little lower. And because it was too expensive to copy the Paris fashions that everyone loved,
au revoir,
we looked instead to our own American movie star styles for inspiration. And what about shoes? Well, most people could only afford one pair. And so, shoe clips decorated with ribbons, or even those pricey buttons, were clipped onto shoes to make them look different each time they were worn. Isn't that clever? That's right, it was Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the only president to be elected four times. Roosevelt was born in 1882, and as the lucky son of wealthy parents, young Franklin floated through a comfortable childhood. But by the time he was elected to the White House, the country was in the midst of the Great Depression. And so, Roosevelt knew his most important task as president was to get the American people back on their feet. He came up with a revolutionary plan called the New Deal. The New Deal created millions of jobs for Americans, building highways, reforesting land, creating airports, even putting on plays. It was a great idea. The New Deal built and beautified our country while helping families feel more hopeful about their future. Roosevelt died in 1945, but many of his great ideas are still helping people today. That's right, it's called the autocopter. In the 1930s, many people were very excited about these new flying machines, which today, of course, we call helicopters. The idea of helicopters goes all the way back to the 15th century, when a great inventor named Leonardo da Vinci designed this unusual machine. He wasn't able to build it, but he knew that one day a helicopter would fly. For years and years, inventors everywhere struggled in vain to make da Vinci's dream a reality. And by the 1930s, the first autocopters were taking off in Europe. They were brought to the United States by a businessman named Harold Pitcairn. Pitcairn did so much to promote these new machines that he was given a trophy on the front lawn of the White House. How did he get there? By autocopter, of course. That's right, radio came first. In 1895, an Italian inventor, Guglielmo Marconi,
come on,
successfully sent the very first radio signal a few miles through the air. But that wasn't enough for Marconi. Only 6 years later, he sent a message all the way across the Atlantic Ocean. That's more than 3,000 miles. By the age of Annie, just about every American household had a radio. And just like we watch TV today, families gathered around their radios every night to listen to their favorite programs. Miss Hannigan's favorite show was The Romance of Helen Trent, the romantic saga of a glamorous dress designer.
Kiss me.
Helen Trent ran for 27 years, from 1933 to 1960, with 7,200 episodes. Quite a run. Guess what? You've just mastered the age of Annie. Congratulations!